Am I audible now?
Yes, yes.
Sorry. Also, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the panel discussion on the topic, Women for Cybersecurity, Cybersecurity for Women. We all know that the age of technology has brought with it many opportunities for women and has been a great equalizer. However, it has also brought with it a set of critical challenges. The growing reach of the internet and the rapid spread of information through electronic devices has presented new set of threats that could put women at risk. Needless to mention, gender-based abuse has also become rampant. An unfortunate number of women are becoming victims of cyber crimes. According to the National Crime Records Bureau statistics, there was a 63.5% increase in cyber crime cases in 2019 as compared to 2018. Also, there has been a surge in these incidents during the coronavirus-induced lockdown. The National Commission for Women received 100 cyber complaints in June 2020, which was up 54 from April, 21 in March, and 20 in February, respectively. In short, the digital age has contributed to empowering women to realize their potential, and yet it has left them feeling equally vulnerable. Hence, that brings us to today's panel discussion on cybersecurity for women and women for cybersecurity. I take pleasure in introducing our keynote speaker for the day, Ms. Rama Vedashri Ma'am, the CEO of Data Security Council of India. Let me give a quick introduction about her. So prior to moving to DSCI, she was the Vice President of NASSCOM. She was leading all initiatives in domestic IT, e-governance, smart cities, among others. With a rich and varied experience of 28 years in the industry, she has had long stints at NIIT Technologies, Microsoft, and General Electric. Her previous roles include that of Director of Microsoft Global Services and Vice President GE India. She has experience in the diverse domains of IT consulting, strategic accounts and business development, e-governance projects, and business development for infrastructure projects and health and water sectors at GE. She is a member of many committees of the Government of India, including the Data Protection Committee, Cloud Expert Group, and Financial Inclusion Advisory Board. Ma'am, the stage is all yours.
Thank you, Vibha, and thank you, Mr. Karthik, and the entire team from the Karnataka Cybersecurity COE for having me here and also hosting this webinar or conference and inviting so many women speakers and the participants. Thank you for that. So good evening to everyone, and also welcome some experts from other parts of the geography, including I hear there's Anuradha from Singapore and anywhere else that you all have joined. It's my privilege and pleasure to be able to address this audience on International Women's Day. First of all, a happy Women's Day to all women industry professionals, women students in the area of particularly technology and security, but all women wherever they are, including some may be homemakers, some may be anywhere in the world. And of course, this year I would particularly wish all women in the medical profession and in the healthcare sector, really special wishes. I think they've been saving the world from the pandemic. So my special wishes on that occasion. So as most of you all are aware, Data Security Council of India is an apex industry body and a policy think tank and a capability building organization, particularly in cybersecurity and data protection. I'm personally not a cybersecurity technologist. I work in an industry body which does a lot of capacity building, and that is how I have a broader view of the cybersecurity trends, where technology is headed, what is the kind of innovation that startups are doing, what is the kind of research that is going on in academia. And I also see what is the opportunity side of it's getting muted somehow. We as young professionals or experienced professionals, we also need to look at what is the opportunity side of cybersecurity, whether in the area of research, in innovation, in training and capacity building, right? Or we are looking at the kind of job roles that are opening up. The most important thing to keep in mind, particularly post-pandemic, this trend has accelerated multifold, which is the digital transformation journey that every sector, every government, right from local government to state government to central government in India, and whether it's IT, ITES, technology, media, banking, financial services, they've always led the way in adopting IT and adopting digital. Whereas now we are seeing a prolific infusion of digital technologies, whether it's on the mobile, whether it is cloud, whether it is IoT and other smart devices in the healthcare sector, in the manufacturing sector, in the retail sector, right? Increasingly, more and more services are going online. And even, I mean, the COE is hosted in Karnataka. The integrated citizen services of just one state like Karnataka is, you know, has always led the way in which services to citizens have gone online. So if there is a single threat that could, you know, rewind this digitization journey that enterprises, small, medium, large, governments are undertaking, I think it is the cyber risk. So whenever any country leaders or enterprise leaders or boards are now discussing, they look at the cyber risk. So when we look at that, what is the opportunity side of cyber security? The first and most important thing is that particularly the Center of Excellence, and it's also housed in a premier academic institution like Indian Institute of Science, or the DSCI itself has a National Cybersecurity Center of Excellence in partnership with MeitY. There is an opportunity for deep technology development in India in cyber for all the emerging use cases for digital risk and for the, some of the new areas. For example, we are looking at a lot of opportunities for privacy preserving technologies or privacy awareness technologies, right? Similarly, there's a lot in the area of quantum and crypto. If you're a deep technologist, you want to go down the domain of really deep technology research. We are beginning to see a lot that needs to be done in the area of IoT security and down the line in 5G security, right? And then if you look at the overall threat intelligence, yeah, and being able to manage enterprise risk, cloud security is another one that is really emerging because there is a massive trend towards migration to cloud, not only from small and medium businesses, but also large enterprises. Several governments worldwide are encouraging a cloud-first strategy. India itself has a good momentum towards cloud adoption. So you look at as enterprises transform critical workloads to the cloud, how do you look at cloud security? So when you look at all of this in terms of capacity building and talent development, Vibha alluded to cybercrime, including cybercrime against, you know, children, women, targeted at children and women, that's what I meant, right? There is a lot that needs to be done in terms of what are those kind of technologies that can be in place to be able to create online safety for consumers and citizens on one side, and for the other is the enterprises to mitigate the risk. So there is a need for continuous innovation, product development, and research. Another area that we see is that this entire fraud detection and investigation and cybercrime detection and investigation, that's a big area where there is huge capacity lag in institutions like law enforcement or institutions in judiciary, in prosecution. Plus, when you look at fraud detection and fraud investigation, every large enterprise sometimes is a victim of a fraud. Sometimes it could be insider initiated, or it could be targeted cyber criminals instituted, right? So how do we investigate those frauds? So forensics is another domain where there is a lot of opportunity that comes up. So some of the things that we are doing is that how do you build capacity in the CISO function, CISO teams? So we do a lot of work around that. How do we build forensics and capability building in law enforcement and in judiciary for cybercrime investigation? On the other side in India, how do we build the product and startup ecosystem to look at cybersecurity? 5-6 years back, when we did a deep dive on cybersecurity product ecosystem in India, the entire startup landscape was less than 50 companies in India. And there were few, some handful, 5 to 10, who were already 20 plus years. Then when we did a deep dive of a cybersecurity product landscape in 2018, it was more than 180 plus companies, and they were close to $450 to $500 million as an industry revenue. But when we just did one in December, we are aware of more than 220 to 230 successful product companies and startups in various areas, in the area of cloud security, it could be in endpoint or like vulnerability management, it could be in the area of threat intelligence, deception, right? IoT security. There are different solution areas. There were about 200 to 20 plus companies, and they're already a $1 billion industry. So for a very nascent cybersecurity startup ecosystem, product ecosystem in India, to already be a $1 billion, you know that there is an opportunity for a lot of technology and product development, and people are seeing success. To be able to do that, I think skills development is extremely important, because we need those deep dive security engineering skills. We need those architecting and solutioning skills when you're building a threat intelligence platform versus you're building a product for your endpoint devices like a mobile phone. The solution architecting, the security engineering skills that you need is extremely different, right? So you need that. Similarly, India is already, you know, close to a $300 billion IT industry. We are serving so many worlds, so many enterprise applications of the whole world. Fortune 100 companies are being, you know, designed, developed, architected out of India. How do we bake application security principles or secure by design, privacy by design principles? So there's a lot of demand for application security, and this focus on the developer track. When you churn out developers from engineering schools, you know, they probably become proficient in a language, but those design principles, so that you bake in privacy by design or you bake in security by design principles, those should be there. So I think you will be surprised that as digitization has grown manifold post-pandemic, the cyber risk has only grown 4 times or 5 times even more. So how do you balance the momentum for digitization, adoption of new technologies, whether it's 5G, whether it's cloud, whether it is, you know, IoT and proliferation of IoT devices in very new domains, including, you know, smart cities, that India has a big mission for smart cities, right? As you integrate cities, as you integrate multiple domains in city administration, there is so much that is happening. How do you build the cybersecurity capability, both in terms of technology, products and services? That's a huge opportunity area. And unfortunately, in this domain, while on the overall IT side, we do see a fair representation of women professionals, both at young, mid-level and senior level, right? Even there's a lot needs to be done in overall women in technology. But in women in security worldwide and in India, there is a huge gender gap. And it's extremely important we put a special focus on mentoring, young students, to consider cybersecurity as a preferred career. There's a lot of demystification we should do, that cybersecurity is not all about hacking and ethical hacking. Cybersecurity is a normal technology career stream, which is hired not only by the IT, ITS industry, but banking, telecom, government, state governments, all of them have those kind of roles. And there's so much that can be done even on the research side in academia and in industry. You can pursue any stream, right, from deep technology development in the area of quantum, crypto, and similar such domains, to becoming an application security specialist or an infrastructure security specialist, or go a little more deeper. If infrastructure, networks, and cloud is of interest to you, you can go a little more deeper into cloud security, or you might be getting more deeper into security of embedded systems on devices. I think the technology stack that spans the cybersecurity domain and the kind of research possibilities, right from application infrastructure, data centers, yeah, cloud, to, you know, very endpoint devices, including, you know, a device that may be implanted into a heart patient. There is so much that can be done, right? You can go source focused, or you can be at a level of an application security or an infrastructure security specialist. So I would urge more young women to look at, as you pass out of your engineering, management, law schools, even in, for law and management professionals, may not be deep tech cybersecurity. There's a lot that can be done in the overall governance, risk and compliance. There's a lot that can be done in the privacy side, because privacy is coming to be a, you know, they're like twin pillars for every enterprise. You need to protect yourself against not only cyber risk, but privacy risks and those breaches, right? Look at cybersecurity as a career. And I hope centers like this, the COE in Karnataka or the COEs the DSEI has in Hyderabad and Noida, put a little more focus on that. And then there is also a need to look at upskilling current young professionals in the work experience of 1 to 5, 1 to 10, to look at what could be some new mid-level roles that they can take up. Because if you've been in the application development side, network side, there is no reason why you can't upskill yourself to take up a new emerging job roles in the area of cybersecurity. So I wish all women professionals a very happy Women's Day, and I would urge more of them to look at the emerging job roles in cybersecurity and privacy, both of them. They you know, complement each other, and also look at what could be the upskilling and you can do for yourself. Thank you. And we at NASSCOM are focused on DSEI. We have a Future Skills and a Future Skills Prime platform. There is also a women program focused around upskilling in technology. I'm sure the COE and Karnataka government has similar programs. I would urge all of you to leverage those. Thank you.
Thank you, Rama ma'am, for sharing with us the recent trends in cybersecurity. You rightly mentioned the opportunities and challenges associated with adoption of new technology, new domains, opportunities for women in cybersecurity, gender gap, need for focus on mentoring students and mid-career professionals, and upskilling them. Thank you, ma'am. Now it's time to kickstart the panel discussion. As you're all aware, today's topic is women in cybersecurity, cybersecurity for women. I'll now hand over to my colleague, Shikha, Manager Awareness Generation at CISEC. She will introduce the panel members and moderate the session. Over to you, Shikha.
Thank you so much, Vibha. And thank you, Rama ma'am, for sharing those valuable insights. I'm sure that a lot of young women will be really inspired, and we hope that more and more women take up STEM-based education and, of course, a career in technology and cybersecurity. Well, it's Women's Day today. So first of all, wishing everybody a very happy Women's Day. Ideally, every day should be Women's Day. However, we thought that we'll leverage this occasion in a meaningful manner, and we will address some pertinent issues that concern most women today in this digitally connected era that we live in. Interestingly, the campaign theme for International Women's Day is Choose to Challenge for this year. It's only from challenge that change can take place. My colleague Vibha rightly said, that technology has been a great equalizer. It has brought a lot of opportunities for humans and for women as well. But it has its own set of challenges and its own set of problems. So the agenda that we have picked up today is women for cybersecurity, cybersecurity for women. We bring to you a very esteemed panel, which is going to talk about how we can leverage technology in a way that it is egalitarian, it is more humanitarian, it is safer to use, and how more we can encourage more women, young girls, like I said, to take up STEM education and to look for a career in technology and in cybersecurity. So with this positive hope, let us start with the today's panel. I will take this opportunity to introduce our esteemed panel members for the day. Let us start alphabetically. We have with us Dr. Anuradha Rao. Dr. Anuradha is a Singapore-based educator, trainer, researcher, and consultant on cyber safety and cyber security. Her company, Cyber Cognizance, it focuses on cyber safety and cyber security issues, including cyber crime, fake news, misinformation, and cyber parenting. She has a PhD in communications and new media from National University of Singapore, and an MA in political sciences from GNU India. Welcome, Anuradha. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Next, we have Dr. A. Nagaratna. Dr. Nagaratna is the Chief Coordinator, Advanced Center on Research, Development, and Training in Cyber Law and Forensics. She is currently heading the Cyber Forensics Lab at National Law School, India University, Bangalore. As a coordinator of the center, she has designed and conducted various training on cyber laws and cyber forensics. In fact, she's also coordinated a training program for officers of the Sri Lankan Advocate General's Office. She was selected for the International Visitor Leadership Program on linking digital policy to cybercrime law enforcement by the US Department of State Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs. She has been recipient of the Shastri Indo-Canadian Fellowship and also a fellow at the Asian Law Institute, National University of Singapore. Welcome, ma'am. Really looking forward to interacting with you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Before I move on, I just wanted to check, has Dr. Rohini joined us?
She mentioned she'll be joining in about 5 minutes.
So you
can introduce her and start with the panel discussion.
Sure.
She'll join, hopefully.
Thank you so much. We also have with us Ms. Neelu Tripathi. She is currently the security practice lead at ThoughtWorks India. Prior to this, she has worked with Not So Secure and Network Intelligence as principal consultant and expert security assessment. She has also worked as a security consultant for TCS. She has a rich background in offensive security, primarily across vulnerability assessment and penetration testing, red team attacks, threat modeling, among many other areas of expertise. She has spoken at many conferences. She has led NULL Mumbai and Bangalore chapters, and she continues to participate in various research and innovation activities. We are so glad that you could join us today, Neelu. Really looking forward to the discussion.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Last but definitely not the least, we have with us the super cop. She'll be joining us soon, Dr. Rohini Katoch, a 2008 batch IPS officer from Karnataka cadre. Dr. Rohini is currently working as the SP Criminal Investigation Department, Bangalore. Her present posting is as the Superintendent Police, Counterfeit Currency, Arms, Narcotics and Idle Division in CID Bangalore. Prior to this, she has worked as the Deputy Commissioner Police, Southeast Division, Bangalore City and Director, State Forensic Science Laboratories, Bangalore. She has won several accolades, including the recent appreciation regarding the various community programs that she initiated during the corona pandemic. So yeah, looking forward to discussing with her as well. With this, I think we are good to start the panel discussion. Right, so if I could start first with Dr. Nagaratna, Dr. Rama was also mentioning that technology has become a double-edged sword. As many as challenges that the age of technology is posing in the current times, it becomes very important for the government to ensure that there are the right laws in place, the right legalities in place to be able to protect the victims who face cyberbullying, cyber abuse. So if you could take us through the legal aspects here, and what are these laws which are enforcing safety online?
Thank you, Shika. I would first want to wish all the women participants a very happy Women's Day. So this is an extremely important question to start with from. So the law framework in India, I personally feel, is quite comprehensive. So we do have a lot of substantive provisions under which various forms of cyber wrong, cyber crimes can be taken care of, through which cyber security of women and children can be ensured. Just to name the few and most important laws that we have in our country. So the popularly known cyber law of India, that is the Indian Information Technology Act, which came in 2000 but underwent a lot of changes in 2008. With the focus on regulating cyber crimes, is one of the most important law under which various forms of cyber crimes against women and children can be regulated, including, say, online frauds, be it financial or otherwise, including, say, fake profiles and all can also be regulated through this law. And also, most specifically, it has provisions through which online obscenity, online pornography, and child pornography can be curtailed. However, when it comes to trolling or defamation and all, initially we had a section 66A, through which such online communication which is abusive could be regulated. But since there were certain vague words in the provision, so the Supreme Court in Shreya Singhal versus Union of India considered this to be against freedom of speech and expression, and they now stuck down the provision. But still, in the absence of this, we do have provisions under IT Act through which online trolling and other offenses that affect specifically women and children can be taken care of. In addition to Information Technology Act, in the year 2013, we have amended the Indian Penal Code. So the whole amendment was brought in as a response to the unfortunate Nirbhaya incident. So therefore, you can see that a lot of provisions were added to protect women in general as well as on cyberspace. So under the amended provisions of the Indian Penal Code, we have provisions specifically to deal with, cyber stalking, as well as online sexual harassment, as well as criminal intimidation and other forms of abuse that can take place on the online platform. Apart from these two, we also have specifically protect children. So we have POCSO, Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act. Again, though it's a gender neutral law, so we can see a lot of online abuse of children, forms of these offences can be regulated through this provision. These are the three enactments through which specifically cyber crimes against women and children can be regulated. But in addition, if at all the court gives an extended interpretation, the already existing criminal laws, protection of women in workplace, so that law can be extended to protect women against online abuse. Suppose it's an issue that has occurred between two colleagues, and if the victim is a woman, we can always invoke that enactment. In addition, Indecent Representation of Women's Act is also wide enough to include online offenses committed against women through which a woman is indecently represented, especially in some advertisements, etc. So what I would just want to say is that we do have laws specifically to regulate cyber crimes committed against women. And in addition, the other existing criminal laws are also wide enough to extend to this particular domain. However, the challenges are with regard to the procedural laws, procedural aspects, etc. And I think that would be covered in the forthcoming sessions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nagaratna. Like you rightly said, that there are challenges in the procedural aspects. For example, the government has started this very wonderful initiative known as the National Cyber Crimes Portal, right? Wherein the victims can go and they can report in case they face any kind of harassment or abuse. However, we see that most of these reporting portals, they don't see conversions into FIRs. So what is the reason for such a low conversion into FIRs? Is this because of victim mentality? Why is that people are still hesitant to report such incidents?
So the whole object behind initiating this portal was to ensure that you get easier access to the mechanisms so that victim is able to initiate the entire process. Because however wider our substantive law, criminal law is, its effectiveness depends on the procedural law. So, and then registering FIR, especially by a common person, especially by a woman and all, is still a challenge in our country. In fact, especially when it comes to sexual offences and all. So even now, a woman might take time to decide as to whether she would want to initiate a complaint or not. When that is the scenario. So when it comes to cybercrime, there are multiple reasons as to why many times victim might not initiate that legal process on time. And one such reason has been lack of access to institutions. Though we have cybercrime police stations, and in addition to that, we have regular police stations which also have jurisdiction to investigate cybercrime cases, but still, maybe many times they wouldn't want to reveal the identity, they would want to maintain the anonymity. So to address all these concerns, the portal began. The portal was initiated by the Minister of Home Affairs. However, legally converting any or every complaint into an FIR, is not an easier task. In the sense, it's neither feasible nor desirable, because a police officer is a duty bound to check the veracity of the complaint he receives. Firstly, the information the police receives should make out a crime having taken place, at least on the face of it. And secondly, within the crime, we make a classification of crimes into cognizable and non-cognizable offense. Cognizable would simply mean something so serious that police will have to involve and conduct investigation. So every crime is not the one that comes under domain so that they can initiate investigation. investigation. So that's why the police is supposed to, in fact, like identify whether it is even a crime, and even if it is so, is it cognizable or not? So a lot of cases are there in which even Supreme Court has given directions to through which it has mandated registration of FIR, provided the information they receive is all about cognizable offense. So sometimes, you know, maybe that ascertainment itself requires time. So legally, this is one issue that they'll have to keep in mind before registering FIR. And every registration of FIR would also mean that you're putting the entire state resource into this particular task of collecting evidence, you know, conducting the investigation and producing the charge sheet before the court. So it's a very complicated task. So I can't simply register FIR based on any or every information. So I have to ascertain it, and for which sometimes maybe they need to make preliminary ascertainment, etc. So I'm not saying you can investigate without FIR, but even to register FIR, there are certain thresholds that needs to be met. So that is one thing. And in addition, of course, since it's an online platform, so there might be numerous complaints that goes there, so some might legally not even be a case of crime. So you know that segregation is also important. So this is where you would need more manpower, more infrastructure, etc. But when it comes to legally converting it into FIR, it has to meet certain legal standards. So otherwise I cannot simply register FIR based on any or every information.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think that's a fair point. So Anuradha, if I might please bring you here and ask you, you know, in line with Professor Nagaratna's talk, that you know, if and as an individual, a woman or a girl has to take certain steps to ensure that she stays cyber safe, what would these simple tips would be according to you?
Okay, sure. Thank you, Shikha. First of all, thank you to your center for having me. And it's a real pleasure to be on this panel with very distinguished women all in their fields and everyone working in different ways to keep us all safer in cyberspace. So I think that kind of joint effort and interdisciplinary effort is really crucial going forward. So thank you for bringing us all together. When it comes to, I know one of the questions that was discussed earlier is technology has become a double-edged sword. And one of the reasons that this has always been the case with technology, whether it's television or radio or technology, if you look at it as a gun, it can always be used for good purposes, and it can also then be used for not so good purposes. So I think the important aspect here is more awareness that we need to bring amongst, in this case, we're talking about women and children and girls, as to, yes, the internet is exciting, it's empowering, we learn so much from it, but at the same time, we have to have at the back of our mind this critical, rational thinking that there are dangers. And so what are some of the simple things? Before I get to the simple things, I think it's important to know where the dangers lie. So in terms of women and children, and I think I can see Dr. Rohini there, and I think she'll be the right person to get even deeper into this. But from a point, from my perspective, what I've noticed more and more, and this is even in Singapore, is that there's a lot more image-based sexual abuse that is happening. And what is image-based sexual abuse? It's the fact that we have become a generation, we've become a society, a global society that is very focused on images. We take a lot of selfies, we upload them onto social media. And I say we as in a very general way, that children who even at younger ages are having cameras, having cell phones. And what happens is that women are and girls are particularly vulnerable to having their images shared without their knowledge or without their consent. So one of the simple tips and tricks would be, and I always tell my own students and my children, is don't put too much information about yourself out there. Do you really want people to know where you've gone, where you're going, what activities you're engaging in? And this is only because the more information you put out there, the more visible you are. Visibility means that there's many more ways for the bad guys to get you if they really want to. And so when I'm talking about images, I'm saying even within relationships, there's an increased tendency amongst couples to send each other more explicit images or more compromising images. And I always tell my students as well that if you show your face in an image, it's you're opening yourself up to being much more vulnerable to either something called cyber sextortion, which is someone can extort you or blackmail you later saying, I have your images. Or we find to our horror that images that we share of ourselves or our children can actually be cut, copied, pasted, and morphed onto other people's bodies and find its way onto the dark web, which means that it can be used in child pornography or in pornographic websites. And so just the very fact that we can think a little before we rush to share our images, especially for women and children, I think would be a simple trick that we can use a little more discerningly in our daily lives. Another thing that I think that women are very vulnerable to, and this is even in the case of a cyber savvy country like Singapore, is love scams. And when we have love scams, we have women, statistically speaking, it's middle-aged women who are either divorced or single and who are lonely or vulnerable and looking for love. And they get scammed by people that set up this brilliant ideal partner profile. So for youngsters who are using dating apps, or even for older people using dating apps, that's another danger right there. How do you really know that the person out there is who they claim to be? So for, again, women and girls, for younger girls especially, be careful with whom you're interacting online. Do you need to interact with strangers? When you're interacting with strangers, say on a gaming site or on a forum, let your parents or an adult know what you're doing, because there's a lot of people out there that will try and win your trust and then extort favors from you. It could be sexual favors, it could be money. So I would just say be more aware, and these simple strategies can be a really good first defense with no tech knowledge required. Yep, thank you.
Thank you so much, Anuradha. You know, you were talking about blackmail and extortion and love scams. Technology does seem to bring about with itself a lot of dangers, which we are not acquainted with. And since you deal with this topic, even parenting, you know, it has taken a very different, you could say, turn, because cyber parenting is the new word. Parents themselves are struggling with technology, and now they have to ensure that their kids are safe online. So if you could share some quick tips, you know, on that regard as well.
Absolutely, happy to. This is something that I work on, and something that I'm developing more training modules on, because I think that parents, so people in their 30s and 40s that completely missed digital literacy as a formal subject, they're not really aware of the dangers that are out there. So I think digital devices are handed over to children as either a babysitter, which is very dangerous, because if you're unaware of the dangers that lie out there, you're handing your child technology without you really sitting and discussing the dangers with them. So I think one of the things for cyber parenting is always monitor and supervise what your child is doing online. I know that's a constant worry for myself and my children as well. We can't know everything that they do, but we can tell them the possible dangers. We can tell them don't click links. We can tell them don't interact with strangers. And we should sit with them for a certain period of time and know what they're doing, discuss it with them. And I think communication is key. But I think as a parent, the first step is to learn a bit more yourself and then work to protect your child together. So not too much top down, but more a bit of top down, but more cooperative kind of, that's for older children. For younger children, you should be a little more spot on so that they pick up good practices and good internet behaviors when they're, you know, when they're young, when they're 4, 5, 6, and they really already know what's out there.
Thank you so much, Anuradha. I think Dr. Rohini has also joined us. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us. Welcome on the panel.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Sorry for being late, and thank you for inviting me.
It's perfectly fine. We're so glad that you can make it. Actually, your voice is breaking.
Can you hear me, ma'am, properly?
Yes, it's good. Please call me Shikha. Yes. Thank you so much for joining. You know, ma'am, you're working on the ground. You know, in your field of work, you must be witnessing firsthand how cyber crimes are increasing every single day by day. How is it now versus when you joined the service? You must have seen so much change in such a short period of time, right?
It's very true, ma'am. Actually, the traditional crimes are no longer that much, significant as now the digital crimes have become. And in this year of COVID, we have been fast track into digital life. Suddenly everybody from my parent to the youngsters have become digital. They've all gone digital in the span of 1 year. So that possesses, like Anuradha ma'am was telling, it's like, you know, we're not exactly digitally literate. So neither we were literate, and just imagine about what our parents would have been literate. So, but they are now, they have their significant presence on the digital world, and they are more prone to become victims of digital in this entire cybercrime scenario. So the challenges have grown immensely. The entire field has changed up. Now you see, that much is not the kind of an economic loss that happens by cybercrime. It is not at all there with the traditional crime. Like the estimate that cyber crimes are going to amount $6 trillion by this year. $6 trillion economy is like a parallel economy. It is worth the parallel economy of the entire world. We are basically having this cryptocurrency and this idea of all this, which is basically replacing our own federal money structure, the way the economy works, the way the federal bank works. So it's huge. For the uninitiated, it's scary. But for us, it is challenge. So you have to learn. This is a new cat-mouse game. The mouse is new. The cat has also to become new. We have to learn and to catch up with our so-called cyber criminals. And we basically have to improve ourselves.
And I think that with every other day, even the cyber criminals are getting, they're using more sophisticated technology, they're using more sophisticated tools. So even policing, law enforcement, everybody has to keep themselves updated to ensure that, you know, in this cat mouse games, the mouse doesn't end up having an advantage.
Absolutely true, ma'am. The challenges are immense, but we cannot actually think about that pace also, because The day I learn it, it becomes old. And and now I'm going to supposed to teach it to the person also who's standing on the ground level, because it has gone down to that level. It is no longer an urban atmosphere. It is no longer the youngsters. It is not even just the children. Our parents are getting affected. Old women are getting affected. Phishing, wishing, smishing, whatever you call that. Most commonly targeted are the older women, because they have that entire, the urge to connect. As our their children, we don't have time to talk to them, but they have and somebody calls them and chats with them, and they're going to open up their entire life, leave about the identity, that's all. And they are very extremely naive about, you know, understanding and trusting anybody and everything. And like, you know, today we are celebrating Women's Day. We women love discounts, vouchers, this and that. You just have to throw that carrot to us, and we are going to jump into it. So that is a typical, I think they have become extremely, they have done the psychological analysis of our weaknesses and basically come out with a much better way of luring us in. So the challenge is huge, ma'am. I don't know whether at any point of time we are going to be able to raise that awareness level to that level or not. But definitely prevention is a very important thing, but we do definitely require industry to come on board and, you know, develop those mechanisms in which we are able to finally get these fellows. Because, you know, a successful prosecution is finally the goal. That should be the goal for any law enforcement officer. You have to take the people, these people out of the street. You have to ensure that some kind of a mechanism is set into in which you can monitor these people. Because they are important. They are extremely techno-savvy. It is like, we should recruit them as ethical hackers rather than them being on that side of the
fence.
So I think it is extremely scary as of now.
Right. And I think you made a very important point about isolation. Most of these malicious actors on social media are feeding on somebody's, isolation, or they're feeling left out. So they will try to dig out your personal details, your sensitive details. And like you said, a lot of people, in their innocence, will share these details. Yes. Or like Anuradha pointed out, will probably share pictures which they shouldn't, and later they'll be blackmailed for the same. So, another thing that I wanted to talk about, and I was talking about it with Nagaratna ma'am also, Rohini, a lot of young girls and women are still very hesitant to, file an FIR. So what is police doing in this aspect? Are you encouraging women to be, keep that victim mentality aside and actually be, honest if such an incident has taken place, for the simple reason that it should not happen with somebody else? So,
absolutely true, ma'am. Goal is basically, like I tell you, fight a successful prosecution, identifying, catching up the accused, ensuring that he gets punished, and taking these people under continuous surveillance, even if they get out of on bail also. So this is the cycle that any law enforcement agency needs to focus on. Now, whether we talk about a woman as such being the victim of this, yes, and in this world now, if it will be very hypocritical for me to tell them that don't do this, don't have a public profile, don't put it on the internet, because that's what everybody does, and it is a accepted social behavior. Like if I tell my child that, he is going to come back and say, mama, you also have it. So if you have it, why can't I put? So it's a reality. We are a public figure. Our things are going to be there outside, and so ultimately is going to be the other person's. Important is what are the basic security etiquettes that we should have. What should be going on behind our mind when we see some sort of a suspicious behavior? And basically 5 most important questions: whom to report, what to do the next thing, understanding and having a guess of how exactly did my information got leaked. Because see, no matter what, how efficient the law enforcement is, somewhere, someday down the line, identity has been compromised. Now, how the hell did the identity got compromised is something that you being the victim or I being the victim will be much better to understand and, play out the scenario that I have to become suspicious of certain things. So these are all things where we become extremely literate about it. And we also contribute in helping the law enforcement taking down things. Like you said about reporting. Yes, ma'am. It's a huge issue. Pornographic material, cyber stalking, the way women get targeted and the scams are there. It's a huge distressing scenario out there. Now, I don't know how many of you know it, but I think it will be discussed. We have the cyber crimes portal, National Cyber Crime Portal, which has an option of an anonymous reporting also. Now, we don't say we take anonymous reporting very seriously, because we are also overburdened in this side of the fence, because we have to basically scrutinize to every complaint. And there are malicious complaints also. There are business hostile maneuvers also that takes place. Not everybody is an innocent victim out there. So, but that is an opportunity for all of us to actually become aware of how we are supposed to report, even anonymously also, if you observe any kind of a pornographic material or any kind of a issue which is very sexual in nature and which makes a woman very, very uncomfortable. And the most important is that, first of all, as women, we have to make our own selves believe that we are just a victim and we are an accidental victim. That victim shaming is something that, whether it is a traditional crime or it is a cyber crime, that we have to step out of it. We have to stop blaming the fact that she shared it on a public profile, that's why it got leaked. She befriended this XYZ person, that's why she had it. That XYZ person was supposed to believe in, supposed to have the trust of this lady. So it's definitely he who is the culprit, and he should be brought to justice. And there's no second question of it at all. Now, there is a 2 options of it, going by the traditional policing route of registering the case directly. We have helplines, we have, I think now I just told you, cybercrime portal is also there. So there are options, and in all sorts of discussions, when we are discussing about cyber stalking or we're discussing about anything related to women, specifically on our cyber crime front, we as women should first remember that she is not there to be blamed. It is a perfectly normal digital behavior of talking to people, because I am not getting connected to you via the digital world. Otherwise, I would have not been able to attend this. So it is the in thing. Now, we cannot ask people to close their eyes and go back to the previous age. It is going to happen. We just have to educate ourselves, become more smart in whatever we are doing, and defeat the accused in their own game. That is the only way forward, and I think that is what we should basically take for this Women's Day also.
Thank you so much for emphasizing on that. I'm sure that a lot of women and young girls who are attending today, you know, will find encouragement and support in the fact that there are police officers like you who are sensitive towards these matters and encourage that women should go forward and report in case such incidents do happen. Yeah, so moving on with the, I think, Neelu, I think let's come to you. So no country, you know, we've already established the fact that no country can ever establish its full potential without the equal participation of men and women, right? So if I may please ask you, how strong is the participation of women, Neelu, in the workforce in, say, tech leadership, in boardrooms, in specialized fields like cybersecurity and cyber forensics? If you can share your experience.
Yeah, thanks, Shikha. Thanks for having me and happy Women's Day, everyone. I'm really delighted to be in this panel. So, okay, so it sounds like a cliche question because I'll tell you why. Because from the time we have started working, I think more than a decade ago in this domain, we have been asking that same question. Because somewhere we felt that perspective that women bring to the table has been missing greatly. When you look at the startups versus bigger companies, right? So I think in the keynote, you were hearing about...
I'm sorry, I think there's a disturbance.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, it's better now. Yeah.
Okay. So starting from the time, so I've been looking into a lot of organizations, whether they're into security, whether they're into tech, whether they're into IT. When they are smaller, many times they would ignore the fact that they really need diversity to be there, whether it is women or different ethnic backgrounds and stuff. And as they grow and they hit a certain scale, they realize that it's not productive. It's not sustainable to go beyond that. So I think that's not different when it comes to tech and security. And in fact, I think it's worse in security that way. When you look at it, the larger companies, as you grow in size as an organization, you actually become very intentional around what you want to do. If you want to have diversity, you know, have different kind of perspectives, have different kind of innovation going around in this area. If I were to share the stats with you, so earlier it was, I think, much lower, but currently women in tech, I would say, is around 17% to 25% only. And even of them, the women leadership is around 20% to 24% of that share of women that are there in technology. If you were to look at the specialized roles, including security, generally it is around 15% to 20%. And this is a figure that was close to 8% to 10% earlier, like a few years ago, which has moved up happily. So that's around 15% to 20% now. When you look at around the companies, different security companies, consulting firms, product companies, the share of women in security leadership is around 7% to 10%, which is still pretty less. However, this number keeps on growing by the year, so we are hopeful on that. Now, if you think about it, what is the real reason for why the percentage of women and participation of women is generally lesser in not only in tech, but specifically in specialized roles in niche areas like security? So there are multiple reasons, you know, it's a combination, and generally you cannot target or say it's just one reason why it is so. It could be, you know, salary gaps between men and women who are playing equal role, but in various cases, especially in the niche industries like security, women are expected to perform much better than men to get the same amount of salary and stuff like that. There's also disparity in opportunities which are provided to women. And in an intellectual domain like security, that also becomes very subtle as a bias. So if you are really smart, you can actually sense that there is a disparity and you are not getting the same set of opportunities that men are getting in your roles or in the same profile as you are. There's also the company culture bit that comes in, and the culture needs to be really encouraging and explicitly motivating women to actually participate, to call out their perspective, their ideas, and also give them some free hand for execution around solutioning in different areas of security. So be it hands-on assessments that you do, be it solutioning around security architecture, around enterprise level solutions that we are talking about. There is also less mentoring opportunities, as you would see, for many of the women, at least for the last few years that have been getting into the industry, specifically in these niche and specialized roles. and which is leading to actually lesser skills in a way, because mentoring brings about a lot of that guidance around being at the right place at the right time and using your strengths to the best for that opportunity there is. So all of those reasons are also there, apart from the general idea of, you know, calling out your strengths, your skill set, demanding professional equality and having that confidence, because you are, you know, you have to be also confident that you are that talented and bring out that quality. Many times we have that quality, but we do not bring that out or we hesitate. That is, I think, something you will see a lot for, especially for new people joining this particular field. So it's important to actually encourage, you know, all those women to come forward, maybe join open communities or, you know, create communities within the organization there where they are and take that work forward. And also, you know, laterally engage them in some innovation, because I think when we talk about traditional job settings, there's a lot of traditional kind of jobs that are already there, assessments and stuff like that, where you might encourage them to join. But the ideas and the perspective that you would get from diverse employees, including, you know, women and other ethnicities and other kind of diverse workforce, that you don't get unless you actually start innovating in a certain direction. So that is a specific push that should also be there for all the leaders in the industry is what I would say.
Yeah, Neelu, thank you so much. I think these are great points. I think one very important point that you mentioned was about these open communities and groups, you know, coming together, because they also act like mentors. And if there are seniors in the group, they may also see certain challenges which juniors might either fail to recognize or might, you know, recognize much later in their career. So are you part of any such groups or any such groups that you think are very active and are doing great work in this area?
Yeah, so I have led various chapters for the Null Open Security community. And I think one of the most interesting things around that community is it's open. Anybody can join, especially those who are interested in security. But it's a very good place where everybody comes together, you know, professionals from diverse backgrounds come together. Many times they're also looking for fresh talent around this area, and it is a great place for even freshers to come in and maybe showcase their talent or create that network and look around, whether for innovation, for research, or just for jobs. Also to interact with more curated minds, more experienced folks around this area.
Thank you so much. I'm sure a lot of women who have joined us today will, you know, find encouragement and probably want to go and check out these groups and see what work they are doing and how they can benefit. Coming back to Professor Nagaratna, like, you know, we know that like Neelu mentioned, it's again a very cliche question, but there was a recent UN report which said that India is producing probably the highest number of you know, girl students when it comes to STEM. However, employability still remains a challenge, still remains a big issue. What could be the reason of this?
Some Ms. Neelu has already mentioned, but specific to countries like India, I can say it has a lot to do with socio-cultural factors as well. The very perception that, you know, women is meant to take care of family somewhere in one or the other form comes up, you know, when it comes to like when she's expecting support from the family or not. Even within the institution at times, you know, working under a woman, you know, comes up also as another concern. It might not be true with everyone, but it's definitely a, you know, a factual scenario. And that, you know, the issue as to what should I, you know, prioritize, the work or the family, you know, always is the question that might affect her, especially when she's expected to balance the two. In fact, this is something that most of the women would have experienced. Even Ida Nui, the former CEO of Pepsi, says the same. You know, after her resignation, she says this was the, you know, challenge for her as well, finding the balance between the two. So everyone, you know, comes across this question. So, so I think for this, again, reasons are many. It's also the cultural, you know, factor, as I mentioned earlier. So it starts at home. You know, that the roles are designated. You know, what you learn, what you become as a professional, everything is already integrated into the upbringing in most of the families. Maybe now it is transforming, but still a long way to go. In fact, in 2012, the Bombay High Court also said that a woman is supposed to be like Sita, follow your husband. You know, this was in the context of husband getting transferred, and it was women who was expected to, you know, follow him. So when this is the attitude of the higher authorities, when this is what they actually face within the family, of course, it's a huge challenge. But when it comes to, how do we remedy this? I think it has to do with a lot with the individuals. It's also to do with institutional support that they get within the institution that they work. Like, if we see ISRO, so we have maximum women scientists and they're excelling well. But then, if you read their interviews, they also talk about support from their colleagues, support from the family. I think it should be a collaborative effort so that, institutional support as well as support from the family is all what is important. But otherwise, as Anilu was also mentioning, it's to do with equal payment, equal opportunities. It's to do with also another important concern is about safety and security of women at workplace as well as beyond that, during her travel and all. So it's a very complicated issue. What can state do? Since I'm from law background, I think I would focus on what states can do through the law. Law should ensure equal pay protection. Though we have here and there a few enactments, but it's hardly effectively implemented. So equal opportunity, equal payment should be ensured. At the same time, concerns relating to security and safety and all should be prioritized. And when it comes to, say, institutions, when it comes to, say, smaller institutions, like factories and all, Factory Act talks about a lot of protective measures, a lot of, supportive measures like crèche facility, like maternity leave, etc. But when it comes to big industries, not many have these facilities. I think it's got to do with a lot of complicated concerns. Each one needs to be addressed so that she gets more opportunity. Most importantly, within the working place, that equal opportunity we hardly see. And it's a harsh reality. So when a woman is back from maternity leave, she might not get back, the same opportunities that she would had. So that's where she finds a gap. And like this, there might be at many stages of her life that she would come across these kind of challenges, which she'll have to ensure that she excels in her professional life as well as, takes care of her family life.
Right. Well said, ma'am. And it's true that this entire question of balance, comes more often in, is asked more often to a lady rather than ever to a man, even though he also balances family life and professional life. Nilu, Professor Nagaratna was talking that there are a lot of institutional supportive measures being taken. There are a lot of companies which do provide facilities, obviously maternity leave. Now we have a law in place, but other than that, say crèche facilities and other such facilities so that there is continuation post-marriage, after they take a maternity leave. So how is the scenario now in these terms?
So I think it's very selective for some of the companies. I've seen that many of the companies, I think more recently, have come up with policies around, people returning from maternities. Some of the companies have gone far in terms of this, and they've been very intentional. They have a lot of policies around specifically, or programs and campaigns around specifically getting people back from maternity. Taking the right kind of environment, having obviously crèche and stuff, but also having the right kind of team environment where the team is obviously not or is collaborating with the person, cooperating with the person very well, making sure and understanding, because there is a gap, there will also be some knowledge sharing required. There is also some training required specifically in this area.
Right.
So getting them back actually means a host of things before getting them to that place where, they're confident again. And I think they definitely end up performing much better, to be honest, from many people who I have personally seen in our company. But yeah, I think it is a reality, but it is changing very slowly, is what I would say.
Right. Yeah, I think there are a lot of organizations like Second Innings and Shiro's, which are dedicated to this point that you made, that getting them back to work. And it is not just, it's also got with the economic development of the country, right? If half your population is not working, say, after a milestone in their lives, then it does impact your economics in the end of the day. So what are these cybersecurity opportunities, specifically cybersecurity opportunities, which are there, which girls can look at and young women can take?
Okay, so yeah, that's interesting. So so traditionally there has been a lot of things that when we in our time used to start from, but a lot of things have changed. So the security landscape itself, as you would know, the industry landscape has been changing tremendously, and that's mostly because the technology landscape is changing, and a lot of new things, including new tech stacks, are coming in day to day and stuff like that. So traditionally we were more into, for example, when you started security, you would be somewhere around security assessments, maybe for applications and networks, incident response, forensics, auditing and compliance. Those were the usual areas to get into and get started. On the defense side, you would have more around security administration and vulnerability management and stuff like that. Recently, because a lot of companies are adopting these newer tech stacks and new technologies, a lot of new areas have come in. For example, a lot more preferred today is things like container security or cloud infra security, because a lot of, relating to the keynote itself, a lot of companies today are transitioning from on-prem to the cloud. So cloud infra security is a big area. There is DevSecOps and security of the pipeline, because everybody is moving towards continuous security in their development. There is threat intelligence as an area because of the lot of new attacks coming in every other day. So working around that network for threat intelligence. There is security for AI and ML, because AI and ML is also growing very rapidly. And things have moved from traditional devices to IoT, and hence IoT security is also becoming a major area. So these are major new areas where it's great to have, because it's great to start now if you're starting fresh. And the demand for this is only going to grow in future. So that's where it is. But if you're looking at more research kind of a career ahead, then it would be maybe quantum cryptography or LangSec, for example, new tech stacks like Rust and GraphQL are more around LangSec and language security. And even there is a lot of emphasis on existing areas like data security and privacy with all the new laws and regulations coming in. So these are the areas to look at, I would say, for any of us, in fact, including women who are looking forward to a career in security.
Right. Thank you so much, Neelu. I think that should give a fair idea to all the ladies who are interested in cybersecurity. Anuradha, coming to you, if you could share what are the fields in technology that girls and women can take up as a career.
Sure, Shikha. I come at it from a very different perspective. So I am a social scientist, and the way I entered the field of cybersecurity was very accidental, and it's a very happy, fortuitous accident that led me here, because it's such an exciting field to be. But I work basically, I have to give a little tiny bit of a backstory just to see how these interlinkages happen. My PhD was on communications and new media, and I link it to how groups are using new technologies to empower themselves. And then I started working on fake news and misinformation, and I linked it to public policy and how the whole thing linked to security. And when I was trying to find a space for myself in an institute, I couldn't find one. There didn't seem to be place for a interdisciplinary person like me, and it was frustrating. And I often heard that, oh, you can't mix the social sciences with security. And in my mind, I could see the linkage. And so I want to tell people who are in the arts or humanities or social sciences, where typically it's thought that, oh, you have to stay in a certain area, that you don't. There's the whole world is out there for you to make these linkages. I mean, without social scientists, how would we have technologists that can protect people? Because you can have the best technology and you can have the best policies, but unless people themselves aren't aware of the dangers, if you don't have social scientists that come in to tell you how people think. I mean, cybersecurity is such a huge, vast area. And even if you look at cyber criminology as a discipline, it has scholars or it has practitioners from the areas of sociology, how people think, psychology, communications, counseling. And so you have a cybersecurity ecosystem that needs not just hard tech, but also soft skills, and soft skills that come from a social scientist or people that are in the humanities. And so I wanted to sort of use this platform to say that let's not just look at it from STEM or policy or legal, but there's this whole other area out here that you can do training, you can do research. And this is what we've talked about earlier and what Rama ma'am said as well, that there are needs, there is greater need for research in this. There's need for more people to be aware of just passing it on in terms of awareness. And that can bring you to a different career in cybersecurity, but it could be a fulfilling one.
Right, very, very important point, Anuradha, that you made. And that is true. While we do need technologists to understand how technology works, we need people from social sciences to understand how it impacts people, how it impacts humanity as a whole. So thank you for bringing in that perspective. Dr. Rohini, and I'll come back to you. A lot of young girls look up to you as a role model. New age policing also, I think, is moving towards technological modernization. So is there a lot of contribution in this field as well, say from freelancers or as a full-time career also? In policing,
I think it is directed to me.
Yes, Dr. Rohini. Yes.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. See, like I told you that police law enforcement is in this typical cat mouse game, always behind the one step behind, and no matter how well we develop our capabilities, policing traditionally doesn't typically caters to digital policing, and it's a new thing. We are developing it newly. Yes, we will do have limited capabilities, but we cannot do it alone. So definitely there is a huge demand for the industry, the freelancers, and everybody to actually pitch in. There are hundreds and tens and thousands of free open software which are available, which we are not aware also. So that is something which is extremely difficult for us to basically, you know, that bridge of knowledge is extremely difficult for a law enforcement person to actually cross. We have a ground level understanding of what exactly is happening. And then there are fundamental problems that, you know, we face in our understanding. A typical criminal justice system, it believes in, you know, connecting the dots. Like, for example, if I even arrest the accused, I'm supposed to seize his phone from which he had made that entire conversation, which is not at all the concept which digitally is followed. The conversation is not there in the phone. Conversation is down up in the cloud or somewhere. Whether it's something which we have to make our own judiciary understand, our own prosecutor understand, that it is not that traditional, you know, a game in which I am basically seizing a murder weapon. It is something much more different. And it has to be perceived different. And the way we collect evidence also is supposed to be different. And in this collection of evidence, production of the evidence in front of the court, we require help. And we are definitely open to any sort of help, whether it is basically reaching out to the public for preventive measures, because we do require a lot of digital literacy to happen. It at across the level, across population structures, across occupational structures, a lot of thing needs to be done. We cannot live into that mirage that, you know, I'm not going to be hacked or I'm not going to be targeted. Now, there are threat actors that are targeting our critical infrastructure. First, that this entire vocabulary has to go down and people have to understand what exactly critical infrastructure is. And be like, for example, if I am hosting a website of CID or I'm doing something, my website itself will become a critical infrastructure because I'm the symbol of the state. And a symbol of the state, if it is getting attacked by any foreign mechanism, it means an act of basically an aggression, a digital aggression nonetheless. But all this sort of an awareness needs to come, and we do require a lot of help from all actors who are there right now in this field, whether it is sociology backed people who are making us help understand what is the psychosociology behind this. We require huge technological advances. We require huge knowledge updation that requires at everything. And we require that finally that bridge has to happen between all this information and all that what is happening with finally delivering justice through the criminal justice system.
Right. Thank you so much, Dr. Rohini. I think so a lot of scope for everyone to contribute as freelancers or as full-time career professionals to be able to help our law enforcement agencies. Coming to Dr. Nagaratna, so what do you think should be the steps taken at individual levels, at state level, to create a more equitable and safe society for everyone? The last question for the day.
Okay. So, I think cyber hygiene is very, very important. I've already mentioned how you will have to take care of what you post, when you post, etc. on open platforms, especially social media. So just being aware of these concerns that information can be misused, and I shouldn't just blindly trust people. Especially children are more vulnerable because they can easily their trust can be easily won over. So making them aware is important. Becoming aware and spreading this message of awareness amongst each other is very, very crucial, as well as maintaining that cyber hygiene. When it comes to state, what state can do? Of course, state can do a lot. It is already doing a lot, including from capacity building programs, increasing budgeting for it, as well as expanding the infrastructure in terms of cyber forensic tools, labs and all. So it's doing a lot, but more needs to be done because this is all about technology, which is so fastly advancing, and not just advancing, so fastly changing its forms. So accordingly, cyber crimes are also changing its forms. So state can do a lot and should continue to do a lot in creating awareness amongst common people and amongst stakeholders, including, say, law enforcement agencies. As I said, a lot of awareness programs are planned and designed and delivered, but more is required because we should be able to ensure that at least that initiation of investigation happens at every police station level, including rural area and all. I know it's too tough, but then it's the need of the day because already everyone has access to this device all across the country. But then at the same time, ensuring that the authorities are also effective to handle the abuse of this technology is also important. Secondly, number of cyber forensic labs we have are very less, so it has to be increased. In fact, there is a legal hinge here because it's only like notified labs. Which legally, there's a lot of provisions under the IT Act evidence, so that limits the role that these labs can perform. I think those legal hinges should be removed. Procedurally, as was mentioning earlier, there are challenges. The way you collect evidence from abroad, the way you collect evidence from these digital devices, a lot of procedural compliance that is required to be shown, which mismatches with the way the technology is being used or abused. So I think we need to immediately review the law, especially I'm not talking about IPC or POCS and all. It's all about the procedural law. We need to revise it and make it suitable to the current day demand. And as Rohini ma'am was mentioning, the services of people like ethical hackers are also important, but legal recognition for the same is also important so that incentives by the state and all can be provided. So like this, there's a lot that can happen, but I think at the end, I would just want to say what we need is a collaborative effort of the industry, the state, the individual. Industry, because many times the R&D is more good there, so the cyber forensic kind of initiatives, etc. If that can get collaborated with the state initiatives, I think the matter can be better handled. For example, if I take the example of the approach adopted in Canada, so there are the think tanks, the industries, the state, so everyone work together, and to an extent, the child sexually abusive material, child pornography, and all to a large extent is taken care of. Something like that in India is also important. Very recently, the government has come up with a scheme through which volunteers can flag abusive material. So something, initiatives like that is important so that citizens are involved in achieving this objective. So again, as I said earlier, long way to go.
Right. Thank you so much, ma'am. As you rightly mentioned, that collaboration is the need of the hour between different agencies, state, government, and even individual private organizations. So thanks a lot to our panelists. I think it's been a very interesting set of discussions. We will now take up questions from our audience.
Shikha, if I could interrupt just 1 minute to respond to something that Rohini said earlier. I think it's a very important point. I think she raised the point that with all of us basically going digital for almost every aspect of our lives, there's a balance that we need to have in terms of how much information we have to give, and I think how much information we need to give. I think that's important. And while it's easy to victim blame, I agree. I also think it's important as an individual, all of us ourselves, just to stop and think before we connect with someone, or before we do that, I think that was the point that I was trying to make, that just that small little step of thinking before we share or before we accept a connect, doing your due diligence. Okay, it's a stranger. Is it linked to anyone I know? Can I find more about them on LinkedIn or Google? I think just little smaller steps so that we can live our digital lives a little more safely. That's the only point I wanted to add on.
Right, right. Thank you so much, Anuradha. I think they say that it's better to be suspicious when it's about when you are on the cyber world, right? Otherwise, we usually keep our suspicions aside. But here, it's better to be a little more suspicious than usual. So, yeah, thank you so much for adding to that. So we have a question on very similar lines from one of the people in the audience. They are asking, what about data being used by big companies? How do you think user can better protect themselves, especially those who are more vulnerable? Would you like to take this up, Anuradha?
Not entirely my area of expertise. I probably defer to one of the other panelists.
Yeah,
or Uma, ma'am.
Yeah, I think Neelu, would you like
to answer? So yeah, I'd just like to say maybe a few things. So there is not too much progress in the area. So this is a lot of area is under privacy, our data privacy and how our data is handled. Many of the organizations have started declaring how they're actually handling the data. The organizations that deal with customer data, particularly, they have also started doing that under regulatory pressures and requirement. But you will see some of the best organizations out there, especially the ones where we end up giving our data to, are coming up now with privacy policies, and many of these, and they do have privacy initiatives and campaigns currently going on all over the world in different formats. I think recently I was also with Mozilla itself is also driving some of those privacy conversations around with organizations who are handling customer data. So the nuances of privacy are at very different level, you know, how much they are asking in terms of data for you, from you. Will they utilize this data? Where will they store it? You know, how will it be stored securely? Can you erase the data when you want? Can you just leave the, so once you leave the account from there, will the data will still be there or will be deleted? So a lot of these kind of nuances are there, definitely. But some of the organizations have started taking step, especially some of the credible ones have started taking step in that direction. But not everyone. I would say it's a long way to go.
Right, right. Thanks, Neelu. There's another question that is directed at you, saying that how did you find your way through this dense forest of cybersecurity? You are into Red Hat teams and vulnerability assessment. Can you advise, you know, people who are interested in such a career path?
Yeah, I think I, this is a bit embarrassing. So I was actually thrilled by the whole ethical hacking thing. I think that is for most of us, it brings us to the table. But then you understand there are a lot of responsibilities in terms of, you know, security and engagements that we do. But start with whatever interests you. There are a lot of areas that we discussed. Start learning by yourself, start engaging with other folks in the community, build your network, have some certifications. There's a lot in terms of security. It's good to have some certifications, because if you have not done any work, that is your factor of credibility. So you can start from there and then reach out to various organizations. Today, I think there are many consulting firms who are looking out for even freshers starting off at security. In our time, it wasn't like that, I think. Someone told me that you need to be 5-6 years experience before you even join security. And then I was thinking, where do we start? But now the scene has changed completely. There's a lot of demand. And I think you can start through all of these areas and then go forward. Start applying, you know, try all your chances and it should work.
Thank you. Thank you so much. There's another question for Dr. Rohini. So an attendant is asking, like, police has a lot of informers on ground. So have you, as a police institution, a mechanism to create these cyber informers? How are they selected? So they're curious to find out.
This is one of our occupational secrets. So basically, it is like, yes, we have physical informers. We definitely have digital informers also, or we ourselves dig out the information majority of the period of time. So that definitely is there, but it is not as such a very separate recognized institution. But like if anybody wants to report anything illegal. Definitely the Whistleblower Act or even anything other than that also as a public you are seeing. So you have to understand the concepts of the law. It is your bounden duty as the citizen of this country to obey the law. And if you observe any law not being obeyed or a crime happening, it is your responsibility to report. So let me be very categorically clear that it is our responsibility of every one of us to report. Yes, there's going to be a fear in the mind of somebody that, you know, I may not be, what is my protection, and tomorrow I may be targeted about it. And there are mechanisms for the protection of such informants or such kind of an anonymous, majority of the time we receive these kind of information anonymously. And we do definitely verify such information also. And they definitely are protected by law, as well as we also do our level best to protect that the person who is basically giving us that information. But like I said, we definitely require a lot of people to be brought on to this entire fold, a lot of people to become aware of it, digitally literate about it, keep your eyes and ears open. The more the merrier it is, because at least somebody is going to report if something wrong is happening.
Right, right. Thank you so much. Any message that you would want to give to women, young girls?
I think, first of all, happy Women's Day, because I think I skipped that part in the initial part. And I think every day is a Women's Day. We are 50% of the population on Earth. So I think, technically speaking, 150 days should be, 170 days should be ours also. But yes, what I try to request everybody is, it is an honor to be born as a woman. And it also is important for all of us to emphasize that just because of we are a woman, we should not choose something. Our choices should not be governed by our gender, is what I'm trying to basically put across to everybody. And for all of us who are strongly believing in this concept of feminism and everything, I think it is, our right of choice, your freedom of choice. Freedom of choice as a woman, if I decide to wear a uniform, I should be able to wear the uniform. Like ma'am said that she was very new in the cybersecurity scenario, but she liked it. So it's her passion. So it is that freedom to choose your passion, freedom to follow your dreams. And it is not going to be easy. It never was easy. It never will be easy. And it is, I'm quite sure it is not easy for men also. But whatever said and done, let us try to, that path, what we are trying to basically lay for our future generations. It should be based on, the entire concept of freedom of choice. This protectiveness, this thing of, you know, protecting our women folk, not allowing her to go out at night. All those sorts of things, I think we need to get out of that mentality. It's a right. Let us protect the right. And as women folk also, we cannot be, too much, naive also. You cannot be, you have to become aware. You are an individual. You're a human being. You're exercising the choice of being on the digital platform. So become educated in having those choices. Exercise that choice in the most proper manner is what I will request all women who are there today. And I'll once again wish them a very happy Women's Day.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rohini. I think a very important message, the right to choose, that is the foremost, most important right. To be able to choose beyond your gender, beyond what are the limitations which are given by the society. Professor Nagaratna, would you like to share any message for our attendees today?
Okay. So when it comes to online safety or otherwise also in general, the safety for women, I think it is women who should first raise her voice and also be your strength to each other. Right. So even laws like domestic violence though have failed because often the victim doesn't raise the voice. So that is very, very important. And just to add what we were mentioning earlier, Minister of Home Affairs has opened a portal for volunteers to report about cyber crimes against women and children. So, it need not be just those informers who work closely with police who can flag issues. So I think everyone has a
thank you
so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us here today. And like you rightly mentioned, there is the National Cybercrime Reporting Portal. Professor Nagaratna has mentioned, even Dr. Rohini had mentioned that you can even report anonymously. So do not fear or do not fall under that stigma wherein you feel that you cannot report a certain incident because that fear might encourage the criminals further, right? Coming to you, Neelu, would you have anything to say with all of our participants here today?
I would just say one thing, follow your passion and break free completely. I think in whatever domain you choose, including security, we all should have that integrity to continue and, you know, stay with it. And think even as an artist or as a STEM person, you know, whatever, whether as a scientist, there will be challenges that will come in. And it's not necessarily because we are women, it's also because we are human and there are situations around us that we need to deal with on a daily basis. So that's what I would say. Follow your passion and go forward.
Thank you. Thank you, Neelu. Dr. Anuradha?
Yes, thank you. I think the panelists have said so many inspiring things. So I'm figuring out what other inspiring thing to say. But I do have something, which is, I agree, passion is the most important thing. And for women getting back into the workforce after a break, or for younger girls and women getting into the workforce, I would say the same thing, that don't be discouraged if the first few things don't work out. Just keep trying, and your passion and your integrity will take you to where you're meant to be if you keep being consistent with it. So don't look at the first few failures. It's a failure will happen a lot, but the successes happen along with it. So I want to just emphasize that whatever looks to be glamorous and everything that we're doing now has been the result of many years of work and hard work. So just to keep that in mind, and that to thank all the men out there that are supporting us, our fathers, our partners, our loved ones, our colleagues, and without them, without a he for she movement, you know, we wouldn't be where we are. We need that whole community support. So I want to take that opportunity to thank the men out there as well for supporting us.
Definitely, Anuradha, very important point, because as Professor Nagaratna was also talking about institutional support, I think one of the primary institution is the family itself, right? And then comes your workplace. So all the men who have been supporting women in various capacities, a big thank you for all of them. And thanks a lot for being a part of today's panel. We had really interesting discussions. I'm so glad that you all could join. Lot of insights, lot of knowledgeable things that we discussed. And I think as we see technology, the thing is to not move towards just a feminist world, but a more humanist, a more humanitarian, a more egalitarian world. Because once it becomes a humanist world, it will automatically become a feminist world. So thank you once again, everyone. And thanks for joining. Great session today. Thank you so much. Happy Women's Day once again.
Thank you for the great moderation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anuradha. Thank you, Neelu. Thank you, Professor Nagaratna, Dr. Rohini. Thank you, Rama ma'am, for joining. Thanks a lot.